Thanks for coming to Econ Club. We have sort of an impromptu meeting. Thanks for coming. We have with us Dr. Peter Jaworski. He's an assistant professor of business ethics at Georgetown University. He's also a senior fellow with the Canadian Constitution Foundation and the director of the Institute for Liberal Studies. So we're really excited to have him here. Please give him a warm welcome.
Okay, thanks for having me. I hope everyone had a chance to get pizza. Let me begin by kind of finding out what kind of audience you are. Here's my question to you. Should you be able to sell, and then I'll give you a list of options, and you raise your hand whether or not you think you should be able to sell those things or not. I'll ask you to raise your hand for yes first. Think you should be able to sell one of the six things that I'll put up on the list. Raise your hand as we go through it. First, kidneys. How many of you think that you and I, and just about everybody, should be permitted to sell their kidney?
I have a question.
Yes.
Our own kidneys?
Your own.
Okay. Just want to clarify.
Are you thinking about having a son or daughter, and this will determine whether or not you have a son or daughter? How many of you say yes, we should be allowed to buy and sell 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, is that a yes? 19, Leo, is that number 20 over there?
I'm from Ukraine, I have pretty bad kidneys.
Put it right down, 19. Oh boy, how many of you think no? You shouldn't be allowed to buy or sell your own kidney. Just everybody in this room, okay? All right, how about blood? Blood or plasma? Okay, so everyone. How many people are in this room? Well, we'll go with 20. Hair? Everybody, 20. Sex? Prostitution? Should prostitution be legal? Anybody think no? Or maybe not? Anybody think no? Or maybe not? Anybody not sure whether or not it should be legal? Oh, sure, okay. How many of you think that adults? How about we make it really clear? How many of you think 35-year-olds should be allowed to buy and sell sex?
I should say yes.
How many of you think, you say yes for that one? So the worry was about age? What about 19-year-olds? Okay, but basically we're roughly 20. Massage. Okay, just everybody. How about hugs? Should you be allowed to buy and sell hugs, yes or no? Yes? Okay, well. So it looks to me like what I'll be doing today is telling you what other people say when they oppose markets and these things, and then I'm giving you, I guess, ammunition for talking with those people. You just joined us just now, right? Okay, let me ask you. Do you think we should be allowed to buy and sell human kidneys, like our own kidneys?
Yes.
Our own kidneys?
If you decide to.
Yeah, so suppose I want to sell my kidney. I'm not allowed in the U.S., by the way.
Yeah.
To sell my kidney. But if I was going here and I was paying your tuition, I might think that a good way of discharging whatever debt I might have might be to sell my kidney. That'll cover maybe a year or two of tuition here. It'll cover a year at Georgetown. Yes?
Yes.
Yes? What about blood? Should I be allowed to sell my own blood?
Sure.
Okay. Hair?
Yeah.
Sex? Maybe. Massage?
Yeah.
This is what happens when you come like 5 minutes late. Personal attention. Hugs?
Sure.
Okay. So it's a clean sweep. Well, it turns out that there's a booming industry of books about the moral limits of markets. In fact, the market for books about the moral limits of markets is limitless. And each of these people here, Michael Walzer, Elizabeth Anderson, Deborah Sachs, Michael Sandel, Margaret Jane Radden, they all defend the following thesis. They defend the anti-commodification thesis. They say that there are some things that are perfectly permissible for us to have, use, and or exchange for free, but not for money. So they think that there's this asymmetry with respect to certain specific goods and services, where it's perfectly okay, it's morally permissible for me to give that stuff away as a gift, but it would be wrong for me to sell that stuff, to do those things for money. In the list that I showed you before, we can highlight things like human kidneys. We encourage people to donate kidneys. We hope that you will sign your organ donor card. We give you lots of applause if you're part of one of these chains that I sometimes see on TV, like Dr. Phil featured, I think, a number of different people who are part of this like kidney donation chain. We think that's perfectly okay, but as soon as somebody introduces money into the equation, and in a very specific way, because it's not as though the doctors who perform the surgery do it for free, they don't. And it's not as though the nurses that work there at the time do it for free, they don't. And it's not like the hospital volunteers all of the different drugs and other things that are used in the process. Everybody surrounding a kidney donation gets paid, except, oh, by the way, the person whose kidney it is, who is not allowed to be compensated for that kidney. The same is true now in Canada of blood plasma. At least in Ontario and possibly in Saskatchewan, the Canadian Plasma Resources is a private company that tried to open two private clinics in Ontario. They were going to offer $25 gift cards for you to donate your blood plasma. And the Ontario government responded by banning the sale of blood plasma in Ontario. They are now thinking of opening up in Saskatchewan, and the Saskatchewan government is considering banning the purchase, the compensation for blood plasma. How does Canada meet its blood and plasma needs? We, like every other country in the world, except for a few, are not self-sufficient. What Canada does is they purchase blood and plasma from the United States, where, of course, you compensate blood and plasma donors. Of course you do. So there's this weird, like, moral magic that occurs in the thinking of the Ontario government. They're like, well, we're not going to pay our people, but we'll pay to buy blood and plasma from people who compensate people for donating blood and plasma. The United States, by the way, is responsible for 65% of the entire world's plasma supply. The entire world's plasma supply, 65% is on your shoulders. Yes, I see some hands in here. Yes.
To clarify for myself, so it's, they don't actually pay people to donate blood, they just compensate them with that gift card. It's not like if you donate so many liters, you get this much, and it like goes up with that.
You get a $25 gift card. Uh-huh. It's considered compensation.
Okay.
I consider it payment.
Yeah.
So okay. That's the clarification.
Okay, thank you.
Were you just saying that people in America will donate blood, and they don't necessarily get compensated for it. They might get a gift card or whatever.
Yeah.
But then Canada purchases, America basically sells donated blood.
Yes.
To Canada?
Yes.
Okay.
That's correct. In many places in the U.S., you get compensated for it, but you can do it for free, too.
No,
colleges
I mean,
often
America
have...
will sell blood to Canada.
Oh, yeah,
that's been donated by...
Oh, absolutely.
American
oh, yes, yes. There's good money in that. Okay. I'll drive on. Maybe we can save the question
so the
unless it's
the government can sell donated blood, but individuals can't sell their own.
That's correct. And that's perfectly okay. But the other thing is not. Okay, so it's an asymmetry where we think that, or at least these people think that doing all of those things for free is morally permissible, but doing it for money is not. There is not, it turns out, a limitless market for books about markets without limits. As I discovered with my colleague Jason Runnemy, who wrote the book Markets Without Limits, it just came out about 3 months ago. And we defend this thesis. It's the Markets Without Limits thesis. Anything that is morally permissible for you to have, use, and or exchange for free is perfectly permissible to exchange, to have, to use for money. We defend a symmetry thesis. Money doesn't introduce wrongness where none was present. There's nothing weird that happens with our morality as soon as we introduce money into the equation. Right? Now there are at least two different categories or kinds of objections to markets in certain things like kidneys and blood and so on. The first set of objections are in principle objections. Here, the objection is that there's something about markets as such that makes them incompatible with some set of goods and services. The other set of objections are in practice objections. Here, the worry is that there are certain empirical facts that make markets the wrong allocative tool for certain goods and services. And in my talk today, I won't cover the in practice objections, although during our question and answer session, I'm happy to field those too. I'm going to focus on in-principle objections entirely. Right? So here's an overview. First, I'll tell you why this debate matters. Then I'll go through the commodity objection, the wrong signal objection. And if there's time, I'll cover the wrong currency objection as well. Right? So here's why this debate matters. Every 10 minutes in the United States, a new person enters the list of people waiting for a kidney donation. Every 10 minutes. Right? Now, here are the number of people who are on the waiting list for a kidney in the United States. It's over 100,000 as of 2014. The numbers have increased since then as well. By the way, here are the number of kidney transplant operations. Notice that there's a slight uptick, right? But the number of people who are entering the waiting list is much higher than the number of transplants that are performed. We are, as you might know, living longer. And that means more of us are going to come to an age where maybe one of our kidneys, both of our kidneys, will fail. Here's a different way of showing the exact same chart that I showed you before. This is the kidney transplant operations as a percent of patients on the waiting list. Notice that it's declining, right? So things are getting worse. Meanwhile, kidneys are the overwhelming organ that people are trying to get. Kidney and liver. Heart, lung, other organs, people are not really waiting for those. Kidneys are the big problem. Every 10 minutes, somebody enters the waiting list, but every 18 minutes, somebody dies because they couldn't get a transplant or they were too sick to get a transplant. So in the time that we have together, there will be about 5 to 6 people who will die on average for want of a kidney. Every 18 minutes, somebody in the U.S. dies. And here are the numbers of people who died and those who are too sick to get a transplant. I only have the numbers up to 2007. I mean, I have the more recent numbers too, but they didn't come in a pretty chart, so I didn't use them. Here's how many organs are donated around the world, right? Here's the organ donor rate per million population in these countries. Notice that the United States is a much more charitable country than many of these other countries. But it's nowhere near enough. And in the US, you've tried a number of different things to get people to donate their kidneys. In the 80s, you had Michael Jordan, a very popular basketball player at the time, and even now, although he doesn't play anymore. Right? He was like the face of the attempt to try to get people to donate their kidneys. What effect did that have? Little to none. Here's what people end up doing in order to try to get a kidney. There's a billboard where somebody scribbled, "I need a kidney," and provided their home phone number. "Please, somebody, I need a kidney, I'm desperate. Here's a billboard. I can't pay you because that's illegal, but please take sympathy on me and give me a kidney. Help save my husband's life." And here's a picture not of the husband, but of the wife. Her husband needs a living kidney donor, and so she took out a billboard to try to get people to donate their kidneys. She has a phone number and a website, bobbyskidney.com. Here's another one. Find stephakidney.com. A young mother needs a live kidney donor. Is it you? People are so desperate to try to get a kidney, and sometimes they walk around with these sandwich boards in different cities, and they have, the sign says, look, I need a kidney. Can you please donate? These are the things that people are reduced to when they can't get those kidneys. These people are very desperate. We know of a way of fixing this particular problem. We know that a market in kidneys would save lives. We know this as a fact. We know that a market in kidneys would probably eliminate the waiting list for kidneys in the United States. How could we possibly know this? Because there is one country in the world that does allow a market in kidneys. Guess what country?
Iran.
What's that?
Iran.
Correct. Iran is the only country in the world that permits a legal regime of buying and selling kidneys. Iran does not have a waiting list of patients waiting to get a kidney. Although they do have a waiting list, they have a waiting list of people who are trying to sell their kidneys. So it's not all amazing. There is a waiting list. Right? And I don't want to suggest that in Iran it's perfect. It's far from perfect. We can talk about the problems with Iran's system during the question and answer session. However, one thing that it is good at is ensuring that people don't die for want of a kidney. So it succeeds in eliminating people from the waiting list. People are not waiting for a kidney in Iran. Plenty of problems. My guess is that the solution to those problems are institutional, and that if we were to institute a market in kidneys in the US or in Canada, where I'm from, or Australia, places with very strong political and legal institutions, those problems would not appear. They would not be issues in these countries. Nevertheless, we know that a market in kidneys would work because it works in Iran, and it would work here even better. So what gives? Why don't we have a market in kidneys in this country? Here's Alvin Roth, Nobel Prize-winning economist. He says, we have often found that distaste for certain kinds of transactions is a real constraint. Every bit as real as the constraints imposed by technology or by the requirements of incentives and efficiency. There's a kind of moral repugnance that people feel to certain kinds of market exchanges. And according to Alvin Roth, that's a very real block on those markets. Right? Here's Elizabeth Anderson. She gives us the very first argument in this vein. It's called the mere commodity objection, or at least that's what I call it. Right? Kidneys are not a mere commodity. That's premise one. Premise two, to buy or sell a kidney necessarily means you regard kidneys as a mere commodity. Premise three, it is wrong to regard kidneys as a mere commodity, therefore it is wrong to buy or sell kidneys. Okay? That's the argument. When you think about things that are commodities, you can think of like oil, diamonds, whatever, but you shouldn't think of your own kidney as a commodity. It would be wrong for you to have that attitude towards your kidneys, and so we can't have a market in kidneys because people will have this wrongful attitude. Michael Sandel is probably the most famous of the anti-commodification theorists just now. He says markets don't only allocate goods, they also express certain attitudes towards the goods being exchanged. When you go to the market and you buy and sell something, you are expressing an attitude in the act of purchasing the thing. Not merely a preference, but also an attitude that comes towards it. And in particular, he suggests that part of that attitude is that you think that the thing is the kind of thing that can be bought and sold, and for him that necessarily means that you think of the thing as a mere commodity. During the debates in 1984, before the passage of the National Organ Transplantation Act, which prohibited the buying and selling of organs in the United States of America, the Senate Labor and Human Resources Committee said the following: it is the sense of this committee that individuals or organizations should not profit by the sale of human organs for transplantation. The committee believes that human body parts should not be viewed as commodities. Right? So what the highfalutin philosophers have to say about it appeared concretely in this Senate committee hearing. Right? But what does it mean to think of something as a commodity? How does that break down? There are three elements of what makes something a commodity. First, denial of subjectivity. The commodified thing either lacks consciousness or is something whose experience and feelings need not be taken into account. And notice that that's perfectly okay when it comes to this, like, cup of water, right? It doesn't have a consciousness. There's no, like, inside there. It doesn't have a perspective on the world. It doesn't have a point of view. That's true of the chair. That's true of oil. That's true of trees. But notice that it's not true of people like you and I. And notice that it's also not true of creatures like dogs and cats and so on. So it might be wrong for them as commodities. Secondly, instrumentality. The commodified thing has only or mainly instrumental value. When you think of something as a commodity, you think of what use you can put it to. You don't think that it has any independent value. And then finally, fungibility. The commodified thing is replaceable with money or other objects. In fact, possessing this fungible object is the same as possessing money. So those are the three elements of what constitutes the commodification attitude. When you think of something as a commodity, these are the three things that you think about. Now, if you think that you ought not think these things of human kidneys, if you think that, like, your body is a temple and should be regarded in a particular sort of way, then you're going to think that it's wrong to think of a kidney as a commodity. Elizabeth Anderson says this, I have this very long quote from Anderson. She says, to say that something is properly regarded as a commodity is to claim that the norms of the market are appropriate for regulating its production, exchange, and enjoyment. To the extent that moral principles or ethical ideals preclude the application of market norms to a good, we may say that that good is not a proper commodity. Okay? So the norms of the market, or market norms, they structure and they shape our attitudes, say people like Elizabeth Anderson. She thinks that markets cause us to be more self-interested than we would otherwise be, that we would engage in more crass calculation than we otherwise might, that we regard the stuff for sale as having merely instrumental value for the satisfaction of our non-moral desires, right? I mean, one way of phrasing this kind of objection, I think it gets it exactly backwards, but we can talk about that a little bit more later, is to say that markets cause homo economicus. Markets cause homo economicus. That's my thesis of people like Elizabeth Anderson. Okay, let me ask you this. How many of you have one of these? It doesn't have to be an adorable black lab. It can be a mongrel mutt. How many of you have a dog fitting any description whatsoever? How many of you have a dog? You had your hand up earlier. Okay, and how many of you have one of these? It doesn't have to be an adorable bouncy kitty. It can be a fat Garfield, orange weird thing that is rude and mean. How many of you have a cat? How many of you have either a cat or a dog? So about half. And those of you who have a cat or a dog, how many of you have this attitude towards your cat or your dog? How many of you think of your cat or your dog as a member of your family? What do you have? You don't think of your mutt as a member of your family? No. Oh, okay, then raise your hand. Don't be the guy in the room who's like, yeah, I got a dog. Is it a member of my family? Okay, who thinks this and has a cat or a dog? What do you have? How old is your Labradoodle?
Almost 3.5 years old.
3.5 years old? Have you ever taken your Labradoodle to the vet?
Yeah.
Yeah? How much did you pay for your Labradoodle?
A fair amount.
What's a fair amount? Give me a
note. I paid for the Labradoodle to go to the vet.
Labradoodle. Pay for the Labradoodle.
$200.
So $200 for your Labradoodle, and when you went to the vet, how much did it cost you to fix your malfunctioning Labradoodle?
I don't remember.
Is it more or less than $200? What are you studying right now? Economics. How much did you pay to fix your labradoodle? More or less than $200?
More
than $200. So you spent $200 on this broken dog. And then you decided that it would be sensible for you to spend more than $200 to fix this thing? Why didn't you just get a replacement labradoodle? A smaller, fully functioning version of your broken labradoodle.
I'd have to deal with the labradoodle as a baby, poops everywhere. Don't want to do that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. What do you have? You have a cat? How much did you pay for your cat?
It's just the adoption fee, which is like $50.
So you paid about $50 for your cat. Ever taken your cat to the vet?
Yeah.
Yeah? How much was the vet fee?
More than $50.
More than $50? Weird. Why wouldn't you just get like a replacement cat? Have you seen kitties? Have you seen, let me show you. Have you seen kitties? Kitties are adorable. Have you seen cats? They're less adorable. And yet you didn't decide to replace your older model broken cat with a new, fresh, adorable kitty. You know, I have two cats, and since this is being videotaped, I'm going to say I love them both, and I love them both equally. They came as a package deal, right? With my lovely partner. We just took them, this is a true story, we just took them to, like, the vet to have their mouths looked at, and they had to have extractions. Right? One cat had four extractions, tooth extractions, right? The other one had one. If it were just up to me, the cats would just deal. But it wasn't just up to me. $2,000. $1,930. So I exaggerated by 70. $2,000. $2,000. This is a true story. I can produce the receipt if you want to see it. $2,000. Did we even once think of not going through with that procedure? By the way, like the cats would have been fine. They wouldn't have died, right? They wouldn't have died. They would have been fine. They would have just been a little bit more uncomfortable. Winston had a loose tooth. That's one of the cat's names. The other one is Howard. Howard is a female cat. What's the name of your, what do you have a cat, right? What's the name of your cat?
My cat's name is
Kovu.
Yeah.
What's your dog's name?
Molly.
How come nobody names their cats or dogs like proper names like Richard? Richard. This is Richard. That's a good, proper, respectable name. They're always like Molly or Kovu. We have Howard. Howard is a proper name for an animal cat. We didn't once even consider not going through the procedure. Actually, that's a lie. I fell on the carpet. I was like, sweetheart, do we really need to do this? Okay, but we went through with it. And the same was true for both of you, I'm guessing, right? When Molly was sick and you took Molly to the vet, you didn't once think of replacing Molly with like a new version. That's crazy talk. When Kovu was sick, replacement was probably not in your mind. You're smiling at me like maybe it was.
No,
no? Okay, good. All right. I was worried you were corrupted by the economics club and by taking economics classes that could corrupt your character, which, by the way, is true. We don't do that, right? And I put to you that most people in this country would never even consider it. The reason why my question is humorous and why you might be stumped when I say, why didn't you replace your cat, is precisely because nobody here thinks of their cat or dog as a mere commodity. And this is true despite the fact that we often pay for our cats or our dogs. Meaning that it is perfectly possible for you to go to the market, purchase an item, and never have a commodification attitude towards the object that you purchase. And this highlights the fact that there are at least two different senses of commodity. The first sense is anything that is bought and sold on a market, and cats and dogs fit that description. But the second sense is of the commodification attitude, which is the attitude where we deny subjectivity, attach merely instrumental value, and regard as wholly fungible with money the thing that we bought. Notice that those two things can come apart, as the example of cats and dogs makes plain, right? And I have like a number of other examples that we can talk about too, like art, for example, and many other things that we purchase but then have a certain kind of sentimental attachment to, and we never think of those things as a mere commodity. So the fact that you buy and sell something on a market is one thing, and it's distinct and separate from the attitude that you might have towards the thing that you buy or sell. You may have a commodification attitude, but notice you may not. And notice that the argument that Elizabeth Anderson and others present is that there is a necessary connection between buying something on a market and having a commodification attitude towards the thing that you buy on the market. That connection is obviously, as I've just demonstrated, decisively not a necessary connection. And so that argument is false. There is no necessary connection between buying and selling just anything and any mode of valuation, including the commodification attitude. Buying a cat does not mean that you have a commodification attitude towards that cat. Now you might wonder, well, what about the signal that it sends? So forget about the thoughts in your own head when you're buying and selling something. Think about the thoughts in everybody else's heads when they see you buying and selling something. So here is the wrong signal objection. Buying and selling certain objects tends to express morally deplorable attitudes. Right? This expression occurs independently of any attitude that the person may happen to have. Right? When I go to the market and I buy something, my purchasing that thing sends a signal to the rest of you that is a clue as to what attitudes I might in fact have. If so, then commodifying certain objects is wrong, right? If it's necessary for me to publicly express a wrongful attitude when I purchase something, then we might think that even if you don't in fact have the wrongful attitude, you might have reason to not engage in that market exchange. Let me give you a little story. This is King Darius from Persia. He ruled the Persian Empire, and he was very interested in funeral practices. And he thought to himself, my people respect their fathers. We all want to publicly signal our respect. But the Greeks do different things from the Colossians. I will bring them both here, and I will ask them about their funeral practices. And so he brought forward the Greeks, and he said, Greeks, you respect your fathers. And the Greeks looked at him and scratched their heads. Well, yeah, King Darius, obviously we respect our fathers. Everybody respects their fathers. Tell me, he says, Greeks, how do you demonstrate that respect at a funeral? And again, they were stumped. They said, well, duh, King Darius. Why, we burn our fathers on a funeral pyre. Funeral pyres signal respect for the dead. I mean, just think about it for a second, okay? Here's a fire. Picture it in your mind. You can close your eyes if you want to. Here's a fire. And now, I hope this doesn't hurt anyone's feelings, but like, here is your father. He has passed away. Here's your dead father. And now, put your dead father onto that fire. Now, imagine putting the father onto the fire. And what is the first thing that pops into your mind?
Respect.
Thank you. Who said it? Yeah. Respect. Obviously. Take fire. Take person. Put person on fire. Respect. It exudes respect and toxic fumes. But respect is one of the things that it obviously signals. Right? After all, a funeral pyre, say the Greeks, releases their souls into the afterlife. And King Darius pressed on, he said, tell me, Greeks, would you ever eat your dead fathers? And the Greeks were outraged. And they said, King Darius, that idea is disgusting to us. To eat them would be to disrespect them. it would be to treat them as mere food. Because you know what else we eat? Why, we eat broccoli. And we eat celery. And some of us, the fools amongst us, eat peas. If we were to eat our fathers, why, we would treat them like we do mere food. And look at the way we treat mere food. We don't always finish it. We just leave it there. It would corrupt the meaning of funerals if we were to eat our fathers. And King Darius was all right with that. He brought forth the Colossians, and he said, Colossians, you respect your fathers. Colossians, like the Greeks, said, well, of course, King Darius, who doesn't respect their fathers? Tell me, how do you demonstrate that respect at a funeral? And the Colossians scratched their heads. They were also confused, just like the Greeks were. And they said, well, duh, King Darius. Why, we eat the hearts of our dead fathers. To eat them is to respect them. We can go through the thought experiment again. Picture your father's heart before you. And now you're eating it. What's the first thing that pops into your mind? Why, obviously, altogether now, respect! Clearly, right? When I think of eating my father's heart, I'm like, well, this is respectful. This is, everybody, look at, look. See? Well, he must respect his father. I sure do, you know? After all, to eat the heart of your father is to keep your father with you for all times. That's how you keep your father with you. Would you ever burn your fathers on a funeral pyre, asked King Darius of the Colossians, and the Colossians were outraged. And they said, King Darius, that idea is repugnant to us. Do you know what else we burn? Why, we burn our garbage. If we were to burn our fathers, why, that would be to treat them like we treat garbage. It would disrespect our fathers, and furthermore, it would corrupt the meaning of funerals. What does that story illustrate? Well, here's the bottom line of that story. The meaning of market transactions, including the use of money, they are not written into the fabric of the universe. The joke about the first thing that pops into your head when you think about burning your dead father or eating the heart of your dead father, the reason why that's a funny joke is because there's obviously no connection or no necessary connection. The connection is cultural. And the connection is contingent. It's a contingent fact that one symbol stands for something else, right? It's a mere convention. It's not immoral. At best, in some contexts, it's bad manners. So let me now, there should have been a warning on my talk. I curse and I do things like that, right? But let me illustrate. If anyone is upset about cursing, first, stop it. And second, just deal with it, okay? All right, what does it mean if I do this? What does it mean? What does this mean? What does this mean? What does this mean? What does this mean here on the campus of Loyola University if I walked around and went, right? What would that mean? Just, I'm walking around all over campus. Help me out here. What does this mean?
Fuck you.
I'm sorry. I had a flight. My ears are plugged.
Fuck you.
It means fuck you. Right? It means fuck you. Why must this mean fuck you? What is the connection between the idea of fuck you and this? What's that connection? When you look at your hand, you know, pay attention carefully to your hand and just be like, okay, well, eating the heart of my dead father obviously means respect. Now I want to tell someone to fuck off. Which finger should I use? This one? Oh, that's like the opposite of what I want to say. This? Oh, no, that's perfectly okay. That's perfectly okay, right? Aha, yeah, it's written into the fabric of the universe. This must be the thing that means fuck you. No, of course it doesn't, right? It doesn't have to mean that. In fact, we could start our own private convention in this room right now, which I encourage you to carry on past this class, right? But maybe not. We could make this mean something very different. We could make this mean, thank you, we'll go with that. We can make this mean respect. When I do this, oh, thank you, you're well ahead of the curve. When I do this, you know, until the end of my talk, this will mean thank you and I respect you very much. So when I do this, the appropriate response is? Or? Thank you. Give me the finger back. It's just a convention. It's contingent. There's no necessary reason for this to mean what it does. And in fact, in other countries, it means something different. What about money? I've already said that that's contingent too, but like people make a big deal about money. They say that it communicates distance and estrangement. And that there are some relationships, like romantic ones and friendships, where you shouldn't introduce money into that relationship because it like signals or means a kind of impersonal distance. If so, you might think then using money within certain kinds of relationships is wrong. So it's wrong to use money in those kinds of relationships. Here's an example. We didn't have time to pick up a bottle of wine, but this is what we would have spent. Right? And everybody thinks that's funny because, why, that's outrageous. That's rude. You shouldn't do that kind of thing. I don't recommend you try this, but if you're in a committed relationship with your husband or wife, and you know, you can't be like, sweetheart, would you do the dishes, please? And she's like, no. It's like, well, will an Abe Lincoln change your mind? She says, no. How about a Jefferson? You can't do that. And if you substitute sex for the dishes, and you'll see my point very clearly. Well, okay, that seems obvious, and Michael Sandel makes a big deal out of it, but consider the marina of Madagascar. The marina of Madagascar, it is customary amongst them to leave a sum of money under the pillow of the person that they had sex with. And by person, I mean woman. The custom is that the man puts money under the pillow for a woman. This custom continues even after marriage, so you are expected to leave a sum of money under the pillow, even if you are married. In fact, leaving the money there signals respect. If you fail to put money under the pillow, that communicates profound disrespect and disclosure. Here's Ding Ding Mao. She's the most famous Chinese funeral mourner. She is paid to mourn at funerals. When somebody passes away, you can hire Ding Ding Mao, who will get a microphone, and will go down on the floor and wail and howl at the death of the person you know, but whom she's never met. But she's like, oh, Kevin, they took us too soon. They took you too soon. You had so much more life to give, Kevin. You could have taught us so much. And she bawls her eyes out. And she's the most famous and the best one because she's the most extreme. Right? Part of the reason why people hire somebody like Ding Ding Mao is because in some contexts it's awkward to just go ahead and bawl your eyes out. In some cultures it's considered like, keep your feelings to yourself. But if there's somebody like that on the floor, like just bawling, then you know what? My crying is like, in comparison, why I can just go ahead and cry then. You've got somebody literally rolling around on the floor, pulling her hair out, crying about Kevin. Maybe I can shed a tear or two for Kevin too. Right? You have this like nice cathartic experience. Not just in China, but like in Romania too. They hire mourners, and oh, by the way, they do it in the UK as well. I just checked this website out yesterday. Rent a mourner. You can rent a mourner. They no longer have prices on the website, but when they had prices on the website, it was like $35 an hour. You can rent people for wakes, for funerals, blah, 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 all those different things. And if we were to do something like that here, if somebody you knew passed away and you paid for like 20 people to walk in procession who knew nothing of your mom, your dad, or your brother, or your sister, or whoever this person was, people would be outraged if they found out that you paid for them. But you know what? That's culturally specific. It's specific to our culture, right? Here in the US. But it's different in Romania. It's different in China. It's different in, not the UK, but in certain subcultures within the UK. Right? And in fact, it's very respectful for you to spend money to hire mourners. Here's a thought experiment. Imagine two worlds. Here's our world. This is the world that we live in. And here's Twin Earth, and it's a possible world. Now notice that on our world, we make wedding speeches. You can buy wedding speeches, by the way. There's a website for that, right? But we would consider that disrespectful. We think it's appropriate and morally correct to make wedding speeches, to write them ourselves. We buy birthday presents. That's perfectly okay. Nobody bats an eye. We buy flowers as gifts, and we buy dinner on Valentine's Day. Now picture Twin Earth. And on Twin Earth, things are a little topsy-turvy. On Twin Earth, they pay for wedding speeches, and it's considered customary and appropriate and perfectly fine to pay for wedding speeches. They make birthday presents, like out of wood, they choose them, whatever. They grow flowers as gifts instead of purchasing them. They think purchasing flowers is outrageous, morally repugnant. And they make dinner on Valentine's Day rather than go to a restaurant on Valentine's Day. And now you can picture our Michael Sandel, there he is, and here on normal Earth, he says, some people buy wedding speeches, can you believe it? Don't they see how this is just obviously disrespectful? But Twin Sandel on Twitter says, some people write their own wedding speeches? Can you believe it? Don't they see how this is disrespectful? If you respected somebody, you would hire a professional on their most important day. You wouldn't just put together your own speech. How uncouth, how gross. How cheap. Don't you love this person? Obviously not. If you did, you'd hire a professional. You can picture Twin Sandel making the very same argument. And the bottom line for this argument, anyways, is that this too is just a convention. There are facts about ethics that are going to apply across Twin Earths and possible worlds. Right? I'm not making the case for moral relativism. There are those facts, but these are not those kinds of facts. These are mere conventions, like this. They're mere symbolism. And that's as true of the signal that we send when we buy something as it is when we make use of money. And historically, the use of money has changed its meaning, even in the United States. And if you ever go to a restaurant and you see a $5 bill pinned to the wall, framed usually, go ahead and try to say, hey, I've got a crisp, brand new $5 bill. I'll replace it. They'll say no. Money can mean different things. This debate matters. A marketing kidney would save lives, not just lives, but thousands of lives in the United States. People are dying because, in part, of our repugnance. There's other objections to a marketing kidneys, too, but this is part of the reason why we don't have a marketing kidneys. But none of the arguments for repugnance are any damn good. They're bad arguments. So we're, at this moment, I'll put this really like extremely. We are willing to pay the price of other dead people, right? Because it's not us, it's not the Senate committee that's dying for want of kidneys, right? We're willing to allow people to die because we are in bed with these terrible arguments against a market. Thank you very much. I have my email address there. Feel free to shoot me a message if you'd like to contact me about any of this stuff. And now the floor is yours, and I'm happy to entertain questions. What time do we finish?
1:34.
Okay. By the way, let me just show you. I ask you, and it's like, here in this room, it's like everyone's like, oh yeah, we take economics at Loyola. And so of course we should have markets and all these things. But here's what I found at Georgetown. There's a video of me going out to the to Red Square, as it's called in Georgetown, with this thing. And I asked random people to like put pins in for these kinds of questions, and here were the answers. Right, so notice, I was a little bit surprised too. The people on the border over here are like, well, borderline, yes, but it depends, right? But notice that, like, for most of these, I notice the hugs. It's a hug. Weird things happen, right? Look at sex over here. Georgetown is also a Jesuit institution. They're like, yeah, buy and sell sex, yeah, no problem. I didn't pick those students. I literally, like, the random strangers who were willing to come on camera to, like, give their opinions on this topic. Here's my undergraduate business ethics students, right? Like, what is, it's hard to tell, but yes, no, right? Mostly yes. Right? This is at University of New Orleans, I think, in an econ class. Here's the second section of the econ class. This was macro principles class at, oh geez, I forget what school, but here are those answers. Here's a different section. Where is that, like, hugs? Why are people are most offended by the thought? When I came up with that, I was just like, ha 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 ha, here's a joke possibility. And people are like, you can't sell hugs. That's morally outrageous.
Why is there grief on the song? Who's against selling
the song?
Now that I use Qualtrics and I, like, ask people questions on Qualtrics, I know there's always a couple of idiots in the bunch who don't take it seriously.
I don't know. I could be wrong, but these questions, they are designed as closed ended questions, but they actually became some kind of ideology hidden in answers. Because people who say no, they might be just people who saying that it should be free.
Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah.
So they wouldn't mind to get a kidney from someone if they want to pay, just want to get it free.
I think.
The same with pops.
I think that's the point.
Yeah.
Right? But you know, notice, so here's a different. So for any, like, in practice objection you might have to the sale of kidneys, so if there are any, like, set of empirical facts that you can speak against having a marketing kidneys, like Al Gore said, a marketing kidneys would make the poor a source of spare parts for the rich. That's like a direct quote from the same Senate debate. But for any one of those kinds of objections, notice that I can always respond by changing the design of the market. Now, you're an economist, and so you know that, like, there would be all these ancillary effects, whatever, right? But in principle, if you're worried about the poor being exploited, right, then okay, make it illegal for the poor to sell kidneys. Problem solved, at least in principle. Right? Of course, there will still be black markets, and so there will be real problems. But in principle, I'm not suggesting this as a solution. I think we should just have a market in kidneys, where poor and rich alike can just go ahead and sell their kidneys if they want to. That's what I'm proposing. But I'm willing to entertain all sorts of regulations in order to get something approximating a market in kidneys. Right? Anything that will save lives is worth it in my mind. Right? So if your worry is that the poor will get taken advantage of, no problem. Before you can get a license to sell your kidney, you have to take a one-year class at an institution like Loyola and pay tuition, right, in order to attend that class. And right away, like, that's not, the effect of that is gonna eliminate the poor from participation. Even if they could get a loan to get the tuition because they signed a contract or something saying that, like, I have something valuable, I'll do it. But notice that, like, they're not gonna attend the class, they won't get the license. It'll prioritize and privilege those of us with privilege, right? It'll allow us to go ahead and take those classes and then we'll have a license. So that's a nifty way of, like, overcoming the worry. Like, can't just ban the poor from selling. Oh, okay, we won't. We'll just make them jump through hoops that look like they have other justifications, but we'll eliminate them that way. If you're worried that people are gonna, like, get drunk one day and then decide to sell their kidney, okay, fine, there's a waiting period. We'll institute a waiting period. Make it a year if you want to. Require a class. Maybe it's free to take the class, whatever. Right? In principle, whatever objection you can throw in my direction, I can respond by saying market design or market architecture, that's what I call it, right? Redesign it. And in principle, your problem will be eliminated. Yes?
Is there a large black market for the sale of organs, particularly outside of Iran? People outside interests try and get organs from Iran, outside the country?
Yeah, Iran does not allow outside people to participate in their organ markets.
gets run by a charity. So there were two charities that ran the service. Now it's just one, I think. The government used to subsidize the kidney exchange to the effect of about $3,000 US. Now that number has declined, and they've permitted, and I don't know if this is a good idea, for the parties to bargain separately. So the government will subsidize $3,000, but then the person who's selling the kidney and the person who's receiving the kidney, they're allowed to go to a room together and then settle on an additional fee. So they can go, I don't know if that's a good idea. There are a bunch of problems with the kidney market in Iran. But your question is about black markets. Yeah, there's a booming black market. When people are about to die, they'll do just about anything. I mean, look, one of the things that happens when you eliminate a non-black market, we'll run out if there's a fire. One of the things that happens when you block a market, it's something that people want, is that you get a black market. And however bad a market in kidneys might be, it's going to be superior to a black market, right?
What's the size of the black market?
It's enormous. It's enormous. In the Philippines, you'll find whole villages, literally whole villages of people who have sold their kidneys. And it's illegal in the Philippines. But in the Philippines, do they have the institutions and the money to be able to effectively enforce their law against the sale? Yeah, of course not. Right? There was a famous doctor in Israel who was performing these kinds of illegal procedures, right? And in his own mind, he was prosecuted, he went to jail, but in his own mind, and in my mind too, he was like, I was doing the right thing. I think so too. I mean, yeah, you were doing the right thing. It was illegal, but you were saving lives. You weren't destroying anybody's life, you were helping. The black market exists, it's fairly large. Lots of people from here, from Canada and elsewhere, when they're on that waiting list and they have the money, they go abroad and they find a kidney and they do it.
So what differentiates organs from blood in the sale, in that sense, in the US?
Good question. So you're asking for what explicit justification they gave to categorize these two things differently. So part of the reason is that one is renewable, the other one is not. So when you give blood, it's like you'll get it all back. You just have to eat more beets or something. I don't know, whatever. And your kidney is not renewable.
But you have another one.
You have another one. And the other thing that people have to understand is that if one of your kidneys fails, the other one will too. I mean, it's not like a backup generator. They go together. So if you have whatever condition will make a kidney fail, it's going to affect the other one too.
So what will happen to the person that used that kidney away, usually?
Usually within 6 months, they're back to whatever, it's all fine. Within 6 months. 6 months, it's as though you never donated a kidney.
There are no known side effects.
There is the possibility of death from donating a kidney. But I know the numbers are the following. How many of you have taken a trip in your car and driven 200 miles? The odds of dying from donating a kidney are exactly the same as dying from driving a car 200 miles. Exactly the same. Do any of you, over your 200-mile trip, think, oh no, I might die? So if you're going to rationally treat the risks the same, but I know you don't, right? When I go on an airplane, I'm like, oh no, right? But like, when I get in my car, I'm like, oh yeah, and like, this is a death trap, you know, and this, like, yay, right? I'm like, the chances are so small, but I don't treat them the same even though I should.
Well, it's different because people feel like they are in control when they're the one driving.
Yeah.
So there's a difference, but.
Yeah. No, you're exactly right. That explains why we are irrational. Okay, but notice that the thing that I'm pointing to is the irrationality. Mm-hmm. That's a good explanation for why we irrationally treat these different risks that are the same in terms of the odds, why we treat them very differently. Mm-hmm. But it's an irrational discounting of the risk of one.
Yeah.
And it, yeah. Go ahead.
Do you know if any research has been done that would show that the supply and demand curve for organs is so skewed that the price would be lower? Like, so poor people would actually still be able to get the organs?
Oh, okay. That's a great question. So your worry is not about who are selling organs,
yeah,
but getting them.
But if you're poor and you need an organ, not
so
being able to afford it sucks. But at least you have a chance if you could, if there's no market for this, then you can just get on a list and wait and try out your chance.
Okay, so one thing to say about this is that marketing kidneys is going to help both poor and rich, because the rich who can afford it get off the waiting list and you go up higher on that waiting list. It would not eliminate
the
system.
I was thinking about that, but I don't think the list for you would be higher on the list, but would there be any donors that are donating to people on that list because they could just sell their organ? Yeah.
So then now you and I can engage in market architecture. We can design the market. How about this? I'm not a fan of this. I don't support this. But why don't we have a market in the following sort of way? The only legal payer for kidneys is the government. And then the government can make rich people pay a certain amount, or insurance will cover it, and then poor people will be subsidized. We have food stamps. Why don't we get kidney stamps? So if you're poor, look, there's a way of solving this problem, because it's not as though...
Or do the opposite and just incentivize people to donate.
Yeah, why not? There is research estimating how much it would cost to clear the market in the U.S., and it's between $40,000 to $100,000 for a kidney. Now, who's going to pay for that? Well, I mean, maybe it'll be covered by insurance. Why wouldn't it, right? In which case, maybe the fee for insurance would go up, so you'd pay more per month, but that's an option. Maybe taxes could help subsidize some of those worries, but we can cover it. We can cover it. And even if we can't, even if poor people go without kidneys, America is an incredibly charitable place. My guess is that there would be charities that take care of it. Maybe the government could have some kind of system. But even if none of that happens, so the poor are out of luck, we still save lives. Now I understand, oh no, it's not fair that that the rich get kidneys but the poor don't. I agree, it's not fair, but lives are at stake. Saving a life seems worth a certain price to pay in terms of inequality, to me anyways, right? So that, you know, even a rich person's life has value.
And would you think there would be, like, more lives? Like, do you think this type of system where people could buy and sell organs would incentivize people to sell or donate or participate in that marketplace? Like,
so if we have a market, would it incentivize people to participate in it?
Is that kind of the argument? Like, you think there would be a...
Absolutely.
Lives would be saved with it.
Why aren't you donating your kidney right now? Why haven't you? Maybe this is the first time you've heard that it's a relatively safe procedure. You have two. Mm-hmm. One is spare. You don't need it. How come? Have you? What's that?
I'm waiting to get paid for it.
Yeah, right? There's lots of people like that, including myself. I haven't donated a kidney. And I don't think I will. But there's a price point, right? Like, so my altruism goes, I donate my blood. I can get paid for my blood, but I don't need it. Right? And I would be willing to donate my kidney. So there's some willingness, but it's not enough to get me into that hospital room. But if you took my willingness to do that, my altruistic impulse, and you added $50,000 to that, maybe not 50, right? But in my case, I teach in a business school, so in my case, it's going to be $250,000. Okay? Right? Leo, I'm sure it's somewhere near that figure for you as well.
For my kidney?
I mean, maybe realistically, I'd be probably $100,000, and I'd probably do it. Somebody showed me a briefcase with $100,000 in it.
Now he's actually thinking about it.
So I do think that it would just push Good, because compare the market in blood in the US to the non-market in blood in plasma, blood plasma in Canada and Ontario. We just don't have enough people willing to give. We have these campaigns. Blood, it's in you to give. That's the thing that Canadian Blood Services uses, right? And they're constantly banging the drum, like, go donate your blood. Canada, we're one of the most charitable countries. No, bullshit. Not true. The US whoops us in terms of charitable giving, right? That's not the self-perception of the average Canadian whose head bobs up and down. and thinks farts are funny, which I do, by the way. 3% of Canadians donate blood. 3%. 10% of Americans do. Do you think Americans are that much more charitable than Canadians? No. No. How come it's so high then? Why does the US provide 65% of all the blood plasma in the entire world? Because people get paid for it. And it doesn't even take that much. You get paid for it. So people do. They give blood and they give blood plasma here. Because they get paid for it. Right? The US is a net exporter of blood and plasma. You're completely self-sufficient for blood and plasma. You have more than enough. What do you think would happen if the US instituted a market in kidneys? I bet you you'd be a net exporter of kidneys. I really think that would be true. If the price was right, obviously. But then as soon as you have a company that's like, we're in the business of buying kidneys, they're gonna let you know how safe the procedure is, right? Because like most of us sitting in this room are unaware, right? But I bet you if there's a market in it, you'll find out more about it. You'll know they'll at least be incentivized to come to places like this and be like, look, it's really safe. Here's the numbers. Here's the life you can save. Blah, 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 blah. Right? Mm-hmm.
So. It's also interesting to think whether or not it would have an impact on like people's health. And like I don't see it pertaining as much to kidneys as it would like livers, but maybe if people knew they could eventually sell their liver, they might. Be healthier and drink less or something.
Your liver
like that, like,
regenerates.
Yeah.
If you donate a liver, they take like a slice.
Yeah, I know. And that's, then I, whoop. So that's what I'm wondering. Like, maybe it would have a health impact
magic.
Where people know I can eventually sell pieces of my liver, so I'll drink less. And
oh, good. Yeah.
Like,
why
yeah.
not?
I don't know how that pertains to kidneys since I just don't know enough biology, but.
Yeah, me neither, so.
But yeah, it might have.
But if you
it might give people a reason to be a little healthier. And, again, like skew more toward the donating side than the needing.
Oh, yeah, that's nice. Yes, I think there could be like positive side effects of the marketing campaign. I think that's true. People wanting to sell it, but like you have to meet a certain profile.
Yeah.
Right. If you want to sell your sperm, for example, not in your, if you want to sell your eggs, you have to meet a certain profile, and you can get paid more if you meet like a better profile. All of you are like at colleges, right? So probably it's a bit more. But like the sperm banks around Harvard pay a lot more than the sperm banks almost anywhere else. And they want sperm from men who attend Harvard. There's like a premium, you get paid more. But you also get, you know, for kidneys, you would probably get paid more if you could demonstrate through like, I don't know, Human or one of the apps that track Fitbit or something. If you could demonstrate that you're a very active person, very healthy, so then maybe you'll be incentivized to get out there and run, or whatever it is, or lift weights.
That could be a better matching, like, if you're 65 and you need a new kidney, you don't need, like, a 25-year-old's kidney, because you're still going to, your lifespan is still, you know, going to be less than 30 more years. So you might just get a kidney that's good enough for the rest of what you plan to live, rather than the first one that's available on the donor list.
I really like the idea of like, we're having a sale on kidneys.
Yeah, like,
for you 65-year-olds.
Yeah, exactly.
You get the discounted model. All right, any other questions? Yeah.
Do you think technology can place a limit on these kind of markets? Like for blood, and my mom works at a blood systems, and they used to sort of like pay for blood, but then they were getting blood that had a lot of diseases that they couldn't identify at that time, but now that they have the technology for that, they could open it back up and pay for it, but the precedent has been set where they only take donations.
That's a really great point. And the reason why blood plasma, the compensating for blood plasma is not allowed in Ontario is because in 1986, I think it was, we had a hepatitis C and something else scare. So our blood, we purchased a lot of blood from the US, and a lot of that blood was compensated blood to prisoners in the US. And it was taken to Canada, and then like a lot of people in Canada got hepatitis C, I think it was, and a bunch of other problems on account of it. We had a Creever Commission, which was like, he was the Supreme Court Justice, and his conclusion was like, when you pay for blood, you get lower quality blood. This was the conclusion of Richard Titmuss's famous book, The Gift Relationship. He was like, if you pay for blood, you're gonna get lower quality blood. Going to get worse blood. And that was a genuine and real concern. But your point is exactly right. Do I think that there's good enough technology now? Not only do I think it, I know it, right? Health Canada and Canadian Blood Services both say that the worries of the 80s and even the 90s are no longer real worries. They're no longer real worries precisely because our technology has improved to the point where at least the things that are real threats can be detected in the blood. You might know more about this than me, because your mom works in the field, right? But yes, the technology is there to beat it. The other thing is like where you locate the blood and plasma donation centers matters a lot. The proposed places for Canadian plasma resources, that private company, they were like, oh, we're gonna locate our centers in more neighborhoods, right? People were outraged. I'm like, why are you so outraged? Right? Like, why is that, first of all, a bad thing? So now you're like, I'm a poor person, and everyone's trying to help me. How are they trying to help me? By eliminating my options. Maybe I could sell my kidney and improve my lot. Nope, there's a law against that. Maybe I can sell my blood and get $25. I need it more than you do. It's like, no, for your sake, we're going to eliminate it. Oh, are you going to substitute it with a free $25 check? Oh, no, you're just taking the money away. Oh, thank you. Thank you. From the bottom of my heart, thank you. I don't see why, but at any rate, they could have located them in a different place, which might have overcome the worry. I got into a Twitter fight with QP Saskatchewan, which is the union of public employees in Saskatchewan, who are like, hey, government ban the sale of plasma. They're like, oh, we're gonna get hepatitis. Don't forget this thing that happened in Canada. And I'm like, all your research is 20 years out of date. I'm like, this is irresponsible. I'm mad about it, you know? Fuck you, you know? Not that I respect you, but fuck you, you know? How dare you peddle 20-year-old research, right? When we have contemporary research that demonstrates, I'm fine with people objecting to markets and all sorts of things, but you better have a really good reason for it. And if the cost of your moral, if the price of you getting what you want because of these reasons is people's lives being worse, then you have an obligation to know the latest research and to be on top of it and to know whether or not your argument is any good, right? Because it's not, I showed you why the debate matters. It really does. Yeah.
I think we're out of time, so thank you so much.